Hey guys, and welcome back to Professor Layton and the Curious Village. Our story so far. After witnessing Ramon's abduction before their very eyes, Luke and Professor Layton are shocked to see him return to Reinhold Manor on his own. Meet Chelmy at the manor. Are you trying to poison me? What are these vile things? You oaf, some butler you are. I'm sorry, sir. I detest sweets. The very sight of them turns my stomach. Get that plate out of here at once. Oh yes, but of course. Hmm? Ah, Layton, there you are. You requested our presence, Inspector Chelmy. My sources tell me you've been out snooping about and interfering in my case. Just what are you up to? It certainly wasn't my intention to interfere in your case. However, a few things don't make sense. Leave the investigating to the police and go chase after that golden apple or whatever it is. Don't you worry about your pretty little head about it. I'll find Simon's killer. Of that you can be sure. Now, unless you have something else to say, I've got work to do here.
Understood. Good day, sir.
That inspector has some nerve dismissing us like that. Like I said before, I don't like him one bit.
What do you say we go ask Ramon about yesterday, Luke?
Check in on Ramon. Where would Ramon be? Upstairs, I guess.
Oh, Professor, you just simply have to help me. I've got another puzzle on my hands I just can't solve. As a man of the world, you know there's nothing women find more alluring than competence. I'm counting on you, sir. Don't doom me to an eternal bachelorhood.
Puzzle number 61. Pinboard shapes. Worth 40 picarats. The cross shape on the pinboard below has 9 pins inside it and 16 outside it. Remember that example, because now it's your turn to construct a shape on the board. Can you create a cross that has 17 pins inside it and 16 outside it? Feel free to make your cross any size you like.
It's probably a diagonal one, so let's give that a try.
Cross that has 16 pins inside it. No, 17 pins inside and 16 outside it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Not quite. What if we make it like a chunky monkey? Except we can't really that way. Unless it's like, how can I have 16... outside and 17 inside. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21. Okay. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. This might be it. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16,
I think that's it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17. Ah, that might be it actually. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. There we go. I knew it would be something tricky like that. Nice try, Professor Layton. I've become too accustomed to your puzzles. That's right. This puzzle is a cinch once you figure out that the cross needs to be placed diagonally on the board. Sometimes the only thing you really need to solve a puzzle is a little creative thinking. Thanks, old boy. With this puzzle solved, I feel I've drawn one step closer to the altar. Yep, that's exactly what was stopping you. I'll give the wall clock to Layton. In coin. I wonder if Chalmie will give us a puzzle. Mr. Layton, you have some skill at solving puzzles, yes? I once cracked a case by solving a puzzle left behind on a note I found hidden at the crime scene. Let's see how you fare against it. Puzzle 62, the mysterious note, worth 40 picarats. A detective who is mere days from cracking an international smuggling ring has suddenly gone missing. While inspecting his last known location, you find the note. The note appears to be nothing more than a series of numbers, but your gut instinct tells you that this note will reveal the name of the crime kingpin. Currently, there are three suspects in the case, Bill, John, and Todd. Can you break the detective's code and find the criminal's name? Bill, well, it's upside down. Bill is boss. He sells oil. There. Bill is boss. He sells oil. That's easy. That's right. If you flip the note upside down, you'll notice that the numbers resemble letters, and that those letters form legible sentences. The message recorded there is Billy's boss. He sells oil. Impressive, Mr. Layton. It seems the rumors touting your skill weren't totally unfounded. But don't go getting any ideas. Do the smart thing and leave the detective work to me. In the meantime, you can occupy yourself by searching for the golden apple. Found a painting scrap. See what Lady Dahlia's got to say. Oh, Professor, how fortunate that you're here at a time like this. I have a favor to ask of you. Please, madam, ask away. I'm happy to come to your aid in any way I can. Thank you, Professor. Could you solve this puzzle for me? Though I'm not feeling up to the challenge, it won't solve itself. Puzzle 63, how old is Mum? Worth 20 picarats. A father and son are having a conversation. The father turns to the son and says, "You know, son, there was a time when your old man was twice the age of your mother. Of course, the next year, I was only 1.5 times her age, but still, that's pretty amazing, eh? If the father is 44 years old, how old is the mother?" Okay. There was a time when your old man was twice the age of your mother. So when he was like 2, she was 1. The next year. So if she's gonna write, cool, I can write for once. So if he's 2, the mother is 1, and he's twice the age. Next year he's 3, and she's 2. And 1.5 times 2 is 3, right? So she's 43.
Jeez, I'm on a roll. Amazing what a bit of sleep can do for you.
That's right. The mother is 43 years old. When the boy's father was 2 years old, his mother was one. The next year, he turned 3 and she turned 2. When you realize this is the only combination of ages that yield the ratios mentioned in the problem, everything starts to make sense.
What a relief. I can finally stop thinking about that silly puzzle. You have my thanks.
Splendid painting. I feel like Layton probably wants that.
But we are still looking for Ramon. Whereabouts would he be?
How do I check in on him? He's not here anywhere.
Oh dear, I'm stumped again. And I just know I'll never find a bride of my own if I don't solve this puzzle. I'll spend my golden years alone, with only the smell of cats and ribbon candy to keep me company. I beseech you, Professor, help me solve this puzzle. Well, I'm actually looking for Ramon, but I can't find anywhere else to go.
And he was in the manor, wasn't he?
You have a single sheet of balsa wood, as shown in the diagram below. Your job is to cut the wood along the dotted lines so that you end up with 4 identical pieces. The pieces may face different directions, but they must not be mirrored versions of each other. Go on and get chopping. Great. How many do I need? 4.
Can't be mirrored versions of each other, I see.
Four identical pieces. Struggling to get rid of the things that I want. No, that was wrong. Let's clear it. Right. No, that's also wrong. I'm trying to get like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 3, 4, 5. That's a 6 there. I don't say anywhere that I can't have offcuts. I grab a hint. This puzzle would be a lot easier if you were allowed to use mirror versions of the shape as well. Since you can't, though, here's a hint to get you started on the right track. Don't start off by dividing the wood into 2 pieces straight through the middle.
Yeah, I kind of figured that already.
Have you ever seen a standard office staple? Well, that's the shape you are looking to cut out here, except it'll be a bit longer in the middle than your standard staple, right?
I only get three identical shapes there. Let's go one more. The board is shaped like a large H. First, cut a staple-shaped piece out of both of the vertical lines that make up the sides of the H. Then draw a line through the middle of the horizontal line that remains to separate the last two pieces. Cut a staple-shaped piece out of both of the vertical lines. I did that, didn't I? Is it like that bit longer in the middle? Ah, yeah, I see. Running low on head coins now, though. That's right. Once you got the shape of the pieces, it wasn't so difficult. But it wasn't all that easy to find them within the wood, was it? Oh, happy day. With that puzzle out of the way, I'm confident that no woman will be able to resist me. I'll be bidding my loneliness goodbye before I know it. Mysterious bottle. Luke can probably have that. Where do I go to check on Ramon, though? These guys don't seem to have anything else. Can't tap on the door. Oh, here he is. What are you doing out here for? Good day, Ramon. How are you feeling today? Fit as a fiddle now, Professor. Perhaps even as vivacious as a violin. That awful fatigue from last week seems like it never happened. As you can see, I'm bursting with energy, and my skin is soft as a baby's. I feel like a teenager again. Is that so? That's good to hear. He doesn't seem to remember what happened yesterday, does he? He has no idea what happened. So, what's our next move? We shall respect the inspector's wishes and leave the murder case alone, Luke. It's as Inspector Chalmers said, solving crime is the police's job. Besides, something tells me that this case and the golden apple are more related than we suspect. That's that intuition of yours talking again, isn't it, Professor? First and foremost, we need to find a clue that will bring us closer to the golden apple. Perhaps one of Baron Reinhold's relations or close friends can help point us in the right direction. Of course, there's also someone else. Let's see if the family butler has anything to say on the subject. Chapter 5, The Hunt Begins. It's finally time to start the search for the Golden Apple. Explore St. Mystia for clues. Any fresh hint coins around here anywhere? Looks like it was just that one, I think. Talk with Matthew. Right, going back up to the manor then, I guess. After looking for hint coins, of course. That seems to be it. Back so soon, Professor. Matthew, I was wondering if you knew anything that could point us in the direction of the Golden Apple. Anything you know would be a great help. For example, did the Baron say anything before he passed away? I'm so sorry to disappoint you, Professor, but the Master never said anything of the sort to me. I'd very much like to help you in your search, but my duties here prevent me from leaving the grounds. If only Ingrid was around to provide some assistance. I beg your pardon, Sir Ingrid. It's been years since she left, but Ingrid used to work as a servant in the mansion. She was Flora's nurse, and she often helped me with my work. Matthew. Yes, madam, I'll be right there. Please excuse me, sir, the lady calls. If you're curious about Ingrid, why not pay her a visit and talk to her for yourself? Let's see, at this time of day, I'd imagine she's out walking around by the general store. Please do me a favor and tell her that Matthew sends his regards. Certainly, I'll be sure to pass on your message. Thank you for all your help, Matthew. Isn't Ingrid that sweet old lady we passed by before? Indeed, we also saw her in that picture of young Flora. Come, Luke, let's go find the old girl. Off we go then. The general store is just outside the mansion, right? We'll be there in no time. I was laughing at tell her Matthew sends his regards, because I watched Game of Thrones recently and was like, the Lannisters send their regards. Bit dark for this kind of game, I believe. Old mate Shade is hanging around again. Probably got a puzzle for us. It's Marco, right? Yeah. Hey there, Professor. I bet you're here to solve my puzzle. I'm right, aren't I? Yeah, of course I'm right. Such a shady dude. Puzzle 59, the longest path, worth 50 picarats. Two boys are playing a game in which the goal is to take the longest route possible from point A to point B, as shown on the map below. The only rule is that no section of road can be traversed more than once. What course should they take in order to cover the longest distance possible between point A and point B? Am I supposed to be able to tell, like? What the distances are? Scale would have helped. Dum 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 doom, doom, doom.
Can I do this? No, because then I get stuck. I feel like this is pretty long. Let's see, we've got. So, in units, say, we'll go like 1, 2. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Alright, so if we say like square units, so we got 1, then 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29. So I feel like this is pretty damn long. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41. That's pretty long. Let's try that one. It's not much more. No, it's not right. Give it another shot. As a general rule, you should try to cover as many of the roads as possible. In the example above, it appears that the boy who walked the green path covered quite a bit of distance. However, as shown by the dotted lines, the roads this boy passed up on his way to point B add up to quite a distance. Try again. It's going to be a difficult one, I reckon, with no scale to go by. When solving this puzzle, many people think they have the answer on their first try, only to discover otherwise. Try to walk as much of the road as possible on your way to point B. Yeah, that's what I was doing. Point A to point B. No section of road can be traversed more than once. I need like a starting point. The area that the boys are walking is a square that's more or less comprised of long and short sections of road. After you've charted out your course and think you have the answer, take a quick look to see how much road you left untouched. Useless hints. Starting out from point A, head as far to the left as possible. When you reach the left border, start heading south. The longest path you can draw will form an S-shaped line through the middle of the town. Thank you. Start heading south. Oh, my touchscreen is playing up here. How far south do I go? I
turn left as far as you can, start heading south. I think I have it. Yeah, that looks pretty good. Yeah, there we go. Nice work. Speaking of leisurely strolls, have you been outside today? If it's sunny, why not go for a nice walk? It's 11:30 at night. Bang up job there, Professor. Even that puzzle didn't faze you, huh? Of course not, you're a pro. Yep, you're a real piece of work, Prof, you know that? Of course you do, you're a scholar after all. Painting scrap. What if he's got another one for me? Lady Dahlia sure is gorgeous, ain't she? Yep, sure is. What a dish, what a doll, what honey. Girls like that are pretty rare, I tell ya. Yep, yep. This dude's so weird. Oh, goodness me, if it isn't Mr. Layabout, was it? The name's Layton, madam. That's right, Mr. Layton. What can I do for you, sir? Earlier we were talking with the butler at Reinhold Manor, and he mentioned you used to work there. We'd very much like to hear anything you might know about the Baron. Heavens me, you want to hear about the Baron? I'm afraid the only stories I have are from when I worked at the manor, and that was ages ago. That would be ideal, madam. Would you mind telling us one? Oh, all right, well, I suppose I could tell you a bit about the Baron and his former wife. The way Master Reinhold and his wife would carry on, they almost seemed to be like children. You'd never seen a man so in love as Master Reinhold was. When she passed away, Flora was all the Baron had to remember her by, so he raised that little girl with all the love a child could want. The things he'd bring home for her, toys from all over the world and teddy bears as big as yourself. He was in high spirits in those days. He really wanted to give her two parents' worth of affection. So, where has Flora gone? Your guess is as good as mine, sir. I have no clue where that girl went. She left the mansion well after I stopped working for the Reinholds. Some say Lady Dahlia put Flora on the street to keep the family riches to herself, but that's nonsense. After all, the Baron cared about Flora so much, I can't imagine that he'd allow something like that. You know, you just reminded me. The grave of the Baron's late wife is located in the manor garden. I wonder who takes care of it now. The Baron's former wife is buried in the garden. Thank you, madam. You've been extremely helpful. Luke, let's head back to the manor. I have a hunch that the grave might hold the clue we've been looking for. Well, this is getting grim. Going grave robbing now. Just have a look around town, see if there's any new puzzles and or hint coins. Nothing good can be said about that tower. I heard it's all sorts of scary. You should stay away, yep. Thanks, that was so helpful. This guy again. Lay it on me, sir. Oh, this time I've really had it. I thought up this great puzzle, but I couldn't find anyone to tell it to. Oh, by all means, just dump it on me then. Puzzle 76, a tile square, worth 30 picarats. You have at your disposal a large number of tiles like the one shown below. If you were to take these tiles and try to make a square, what is the fewest number of tiles you'd need? Ugh. 12, 24, 36, 48, 65, 5 equals 60 by 50. It's not going to make a square, is it? If you keep adding 0.5 inches on top of each other, it'd have to be. I'm gonna make a square. I feel like it's not possible because. No, it'd be 4. Because I could go like. So which way is longer this way? So 10, 12, and then like say 10, so a bit of a rectangle. Then if you go 10 and then 12 like that, and then 10 and then 12, and then 10 and 12, it'd be 4.
Just rotate them on the side and there'll be a gap in the middle. No? Okay.
Try approaching it from a different angle and see where that takes you. We'll see, then I was thinking I could stack them up by like 24 high. 24 of these high, but that'd be like a cube kind of thing, or a rectangular prism. Be a square this way though.
Since the tiles have a different length and width, you'll need to find a number that can be divided by both dimensions. Find a number that can be divided by both dimensions. 120 and 60. But if you go 120, it'll be 10 tiles this way. Hang on. 12, 24, 36, 48, 60. So it'd be 5 tiles this way. And 6 tiles this way to get 60. Which is not a square, as we all know. But it'd be the same dimension. Obviously. It'd be 60 by 60. Doesn't matter that the tiles are uneven, because they're longer. That's way too many. I'm assuming it's not 30 tiles then. I'm assuming it's not going to be 30. 6 by 5. In order to make a square. Hang on. Right, so if you want, what is it, 5 this way by 6 this way, then we have something like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. But then what if we don't want any of these middle ones? So we end up with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. I feel like that's gonna be right. No? And it's not full. Because if we just have... Yeah. Don't forget that the puzzle also gives you the thickness of the tiles. Yeah, well... A cube though. Why are you giving me the thickness? Is it 20? 0.5 times 20 is 10. That's what I thought. Rectangular prism. Jerk. Oh, come on. I was all ready to tell you the answer and everything. But no, you had to go and ruin it by answering before I said it was okay, didn't you? Didn't you? Have you ever considered the strong possibility that you might be a jerk? Got another one for me? Nope. She does though, I think. Tee hee hee, who are you looking for this time? Want to rest for a minute and solve this puzzle? Number 77, which job? Worth 20 picarats. Two corporations have put out help wanted ads. Aside from the information below, the two companies' offers are exactly the same. From a purely financial standpoint, which one should you work for? Company A will pay you $100,000 a year and give you a $20,000 raise yearly. Company B will pay you $50,000 every 6 months and give you a $5,000 raise every 6 months. Wish I could write down. Alright, $20,000 a year. No, $100,000 a year. $20,000 a year. Depends how long you want to work for them. Okay, say we work for 1 year. We get $100,000 for the first year. At company A, then company B, we get $100,000 for the year. No, we get $105,000 for the year. Then... the next year, so we're up to what, $100,000, and then $105,000. Then the next year, up to $220,000 at A total, and B, we're up to plus 20,000. I'm feeling like it's company B every time though. Okay, let's just work out A. $100,000 for the first year. Then by the second year we have $220,000 total. Then for B we have 50,000 in the first 6 months, then 105,000 at the end of the year. Then next we have 155 plus 5, 160,000. Then 210, 215,000. No, that's not right. Because it's 50, then 55, then 60,000. Then 65. So 50 plus 55 is 105,000. Then 60, 165,000. Then 60, 55. Oh my god. I think it's B anyway. I think it's slightly ahead. Critical thinking is the key to success. As seen in the image above, if you actually calculate things out, you'll see that the salary for Company B will always be $5,000 higher than the corresponding salary at Company A. Yeah, 100,000, then 50 plus 55, 120,000, 60 plus 65. Yeah, I should have just done it as a year. Stop trying to do total. Would have been easier, I think. Oh, you did it. Okay, I guess I should give you some info as a reward. You know Lady Dahlia, right? She's planning to keep the fortune to herself once it's found. And you've been helping her all along. Don't you feel so dumb? Houseplant, where will it go? Let's give it to Luke. And with that, I think we might call it an episode. Heatcoin. I'd like to thank you for joining me today for Professor Layton and the Curious Village. And I hope to see you next time.